Thank you. That concludes general questions. We move to First Minister's questions. At question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Public Health Scotland figures show that delayed discharge, also known as bed blocking, is at a record high. And another set of new figures reveal, according to the charity Macmillan, their words, devastating delays in cancer treatment. And right now, one in seven of our fellow Scots is on an NHS waiting list. So given all of this, why does our health service not make it onto the first page of the SNP's priorities?
First Minister.
As I've explained to Parliament before, the issues that Douglas Ross raises with me of delayed discharges, which I accept are far too high, and the Government is in active dialogue with local authorities and health boards to reduce those numbers. Cancer waiting times, we're treating more patients with cancer, with increased personnel in the health service working to deliver on cancer care. And within the health service as a whole, we are allocating more resources to ensure that the health service is able to meet the rising demand, which has increased in the aftermath of COVID, with the health service occupying a much larger proportion of our budget than was the case before. But there is, of course, a link between the condition of the health service and the question of independence, and that is the question of financial control. And what worries me, and it's not just me, it's been expressed by the Institute for Fiscal Studies as well, is there a conspiracy of silence at this moment about the funding of our public services and our health service between the Conservatives and the Labour Party? And the issue is this. We are not confronting the consequences of 14 years of austerity, but for Scotland, independence is the way to do that.
Douglas Ross.
I was speaking about Macmillan saying there are devastating delays in cancer treatment, and John Swinney goes for independence. And he spoke about delayed discharge and said he was in active dialogue with local authorities. Yes, that active dialogue is telling them they're getting their budgets cut yet again by this SNP Scottish Government. On the SNP's watch, Scotland's NHS waiting times are at some of their worst levels ever. They've made Scotland the drug desk capital of Europe. Alcohol deaths are now at the highest level for 16 years, and life expectancy in Scotland is lower. Life expectancy in our country is lower after the 17 years of the SNP government. The SNP are bad for Scotland's health. Now, we're all sick of hearing about what's on page one, line one. But fixing Scotland's broken NHS is the public's priority. So why isn't it the SNP's priority?
First Minister.
Well, I think the decisions of the government speak volumes about what priority we attach to the health service. So
let's hear the First Minister.
When this government came to office in 2007, the health service occupied about 33% of the government's budget. Today, it is closer to 50%. Those are the decisions this government has taken. And that has ensured that there is more funding to deal with the increased demand there is in the National Health Service. Now, when the government had a choice last year about the allocation of consequential funding from the United Kingdom government, we faced a choice. The consequentials came for business rate support for the hospitality industry. When that money came here, Douglas Ross wanted us to spend it on the hospitality sector, and we chose to spend it on the health service. We're prepared to make the tough choices. Douglas Ross ducks them.
Douglas Ross.
John Swinney wants to get applause from the clapping seals behind him for record drug deaths in Scotland. He
members,
wants us to celebrate.
Members, Mr. Ross, yet again, I must draw your attention to Standing Order Rule 7.3, which tells us that we must conduct our business in a courteous and respectful manner. Do continue in that vein. Thank you.
I was just listing the point that the SNP were applauding John Swinney. The SNP were applauding John Swinney for overseeing record drug deaths in Europe. We're the worst in Europe. They applaud that. We have bed blocking at its highest ever level. They applaud that. We have people waiting on waiting lists far longer than they should. 840,000 of our fellow Scots and SNP MSPs applaud it. But it's not just our health service where the SNP have failed. They haven't upgraded the key roads that they promised they would. The A9, the A90, the A96, the A7, the A75, the A77. All of these promises broken by the SNP. The attainment gap was supposed to close. It's widened. Violent crime is up. Officer numbers are down. Scottish workers pay more in tax than the rest of the United Kingdom, and they have abandoned Scotland's oil and gas industry. From salmon to sturgeon to Swinney, all they have achieved is dividing Scotland. Isn't it time to finally draw a line under the independence debate for good?
First Minister.
One of the issues that Douglas Ross put to me was about alcohol-related deaths. Now, I want to share a quote with Parliament because this is the type of evidence that Parliament needs to chew over and consider when we're dealing with the kind of rhetoric that we hear from Douglas Ross. Professor Jerry McCartney, the Professor of Wellbeing and Economy at Glasgow University, said this, and I quote, "You see lagged effects from decades ago of urban planning, policy decisions and the 1980s economic changes and how that translated into people's alcohol deaths a decade or two decades later. So it is not unprecedented." I simply put that evidence to Parliament because we have to understand the consequences of the devastation wreaked on our country by the policies of Margaret Thatcher's Conservative government. And just to prolong the absurdity of Douglas Ross's position, Douglas Ross has set out a manifesto this week which commits to repairing the roads, ending long NHS waits, restoring schools, making Scotland safer.
Let's hear the First Minister.
All of those four commitments cost more money.
Yeah.
And then the fifth one. Cut your tax. So Douglas Ross stands here, demands that we do more and demands that we spend less. It is the politics of absurdity, and Douglas Ross is welcome to all of it.
Douglas Ross.
Let's just look at that answer. Now, John Swinney is considerably older than me, but he is blaming the failures here in Scotland now to a period before I was even born, and apparently it has nothing to do with the 17 years the SNP have been in charge here in Scotland. And we know that apart from separating Scotland from the rest of the UK, nothing else matters to John Swinney. Independence will always come first. Before our NHS, before jobs, before schools, before the economy, before everything. People up and down Scotland want the focus to be on these issues, the things that really matter to them. But we all know what John Swinney wants. If it's not page one, line one, it's not a priority for the SNP. Right now in 2024, the SNP's leader from 2004 is trying to take us back to the division of 2014. Scotland is stagnating under the SNP. We've had 17 years of decline and broken promises. Isn't it time to finally move on from the division of this SNP government to focus on the issues that really matter to people?
First Minister.
I don't really think Douglas Ross is in a position to go on at me about division when his colleagues behind him have told him to get out of office as leader of the Scottish Conservative Party. Oh, do they all want him to stay? Well, what I read in the newspapers was they were all in revolt. They all wanted rid of him. So, I think my colleagues are pretty happy that I'm here just now, believe you me. And let me
Let's hear one another.
And let me just tell Douglas Ross why independence matters. People in this country are suffering because of the...
We will hear the First Minister.
Because of the consequences of 14 years of Conservative austerity. They are suffering because of the Conservative obsession with Brexit, which is damaging our economy. They are suffering because of the cost of living crisis escalated by the ludicrous behaviour of Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng, which Douglas Ross wanted me to emulate. Independence is the solution to austerity, Brexit and the cost of living. And we're going to see the back of Douglas Ross as well.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
President Officer, long waits are forcing those who can afford it to go private. A two-tier health service in Scotland is now beyond question. If you can stump up the cash, then you can get the care you need. But we all value an NHS free at the point of use. Yet Scotland is sleepwalking into sacrificing this principle, threatening the very existence of the National Health Service as we know it. Not my words, Presiding Officer, the words of Dr Ian Kennedy, the Chair of BMA Scotland, talking about the NHS in Scotland right now on the SNP's watch. Is Dr Kennedy wrong?
First Minister.
I have the greatest respect for the comments of Dr Kennedy, and I listened and read Dr Kennedy's comments with great care, and I take them seriously, because Dr Kennedy makes a significant warning to us about what lies ahead. Absolutely. I have been completely candid. This will be interesting to see, because you know, I don't think it's any secret that we're going to have a Labour government in a little while time. And we're going to have to see how the dialogue develops here. Because in about, I don't know, a week on Friday, the issues that have been raised with me about the health service are going to be the Labour Party's problem. And they're going to have to engage... Mr Mara, I don't need you to shout at me about taking responsibility. I take my responsibilities deadly seriously. But what I'm calling for is a serious conversation about what lies ahead. Because the health service is a product of the investment we can make through the public finances. And as I've just explained to Mr Ross, when we came to office, the health service occupied 33% of our budget, and it now occupies nearly 50%. So we've taken the hard decisions, including increasing tax on higher earners, to invest more in the health service, which Mr Mara and Mr Sarwar want us to reverse. Now, if we look ahead, the Labour Party is proposing an extra £134 million of investment in the health service in Scotland as a consequence of their election victory. That's what they're offering. The last spring budget health consequentials that we got from the awful Tories were £237 million. So I invite Anna Sarwar to do the maths. We cannot prolong austerity, and that's what the Labour Party is offering. And until the Labour Party offers a sensible way out of austerity, people in Scotland won't take it all seriously.
Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, sir. That is frankly an embarrassing response. You have been in charge of the NHS for 17 years, and the chair of the BMA is saying we now have a two-tier health service under an SNP government, and all Jim Swinney spoke about was what would happen if, as I hope, and many in Scotland hope too, we get a Labour government after the 4th of July. What about this government's responsibility and what's happening to people right now? Because the reality of Dr Kennedy's comments is that many people feel they have to pay because they've been waiting too long for treatment. No answers from John Swinney to those people. And nothing sums up SNP waiting time failure like cancer. 2 weeks ago, I highlighted the scandal of cancer patients having to pay privately for chemotherapy. Think about that for a moment, Mr Swinney, when you give your next answer. Cancer is Scotland's biggest killer. It has touched every family in Scotland. And on Tuesday, it was confirmed that under this SNP government, We have failed to meet the 62-day treatment standard for cancer treatment. In fact, it's not been met for 12 years. And in that time, almost 26,000 cancer patients have waited too long. 5,000 patients in the last year alone. So how much longer do these cancer patients and their families need to listen to this SNP government blame somebody else for their own government's failure?
Always through the chair, please. First Minister.
So let me go through some of the steps that we've taken to strengthen cancer care within Scotland and to demonstrate the increased level of activity that is taking place. Firstly, in relation to the significant increase in postings that we have in cancer care, we have funded the creation of 15 extra posts in clinical oncology, 6 in medical oncology, 68 in clinical radiology, and 10 in clinical interventional radiology. There has been a 50% increase in consultant oncologists in the last decade, and we've increased the number of consultant radiologists by 34% over the same period. Now, if we look at the volume of individuals being treated, over 15% more patients were treated on 62-day urgent suspicion of cancer pathway than in late 2019 before the COVID pandemic. And that is 47% more than 10 years ago. 22% more patients were treated on the 31-day pathway compared to 10 years ago. So my answers there are directly addressing Mr. Sarwar's point about what are we doing to treat and support more people. We're expanding the number of people delivering that specialist care, and we are making sure that more patients are being treated on both the 31-day and the 62-day pathways. Now, there are also other measures being taken, such as, for example, the rapid cancer diagnostic services that are now being delivered in parts of the country. In NHS 5, for example, the average wait for referral from diagnosis has gone from 77.5 days to 11.4 days. In Dumfries and Galloway, that average wait has gone from 78.7 days to 13.6 days. So I put that information on the record to reassure members of the public that the government is investing, we are treating more people, and more people are being treated more quickly. But I accept there remain challenges in the delivery of healthcare and in cancer care, and that is why I believe we have to have an honest conversation about the financial support that is required to support investment in our health service.
Yep, absolutely. There are many members who wish to put questions today, and I'd be grateful for more concise questions and responses. Anna Sarwar.
I can't wait to have that honest conversation about the performance of this SNP government when it comes to the NHS in the run-up to election in 2026, and neither can many people across the country. 5,000 patients last year waited too long to get their cancer treatment. And I said last week that long waits cost lives, because we all know that the faster someone gets treatment, the higher their chances of survival from cancer. Now, earlier this month, Professor Farah Din of the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh told the Scottish Parliament Health Committee, and I quote, "As a cancer surgeon, when patients in my clinic ask me when their operation will be, that is a very difficult conversation to have. Each of those people is part of a family, and their anxiety is for them. There's also anxiety for our clinicians, because we are trying to deliver care, but we cannot deliver the high standard of care that we've been trained to deliver." First Minister, 26,000 cancer patients and their families have faced this anxiety and waited too long on the SNP's watch. Can you explain why to them and their doctors?
First Minister.
I've set out in considerable detail, and the presiding officer has asked me to keep my remarks limited, so I won't repeat all that I've just put on the record in my answer. But what I said in my answer is a demonstration of two things. One, the investment in specialism and specialist capacity to enable us to treat cancer patients. Yeah. And two, being prepared to put the resources in to enable that to happen. Yeah. That has not happened by accident. It happened because ministers in this government took a decision to increase tax for higher earners so we could spend more on health than was provided by the UK government in consequentials. Yep. And secondly, that we decided not to pass on a Barnett consequential to the hospitality sector, but instead to invest that in the National Health Service. Now, I'm contributing to the debate just now, acknowledging the significant pressures on the National Health Service, but also the significant burden created by prolonged austerity. What I worry about, and I worry about it deeply, is I do not hear a willingness on the part of the Labour Party to take a different course of direction, to invest more in our National Health Service to ensure we can deliver the care that people require. And I want to make sure that that is well understood by people in the course of the next week, to ensure that people are fully informed about the limitations of the position that has been offered by the Labour Party, and to demonstrate the commitments that we have given to put our money where our mouth is, to put taxes up, to increase investment in the National Health Service, and to deliver for the people of this country.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
The Cabinet will next meet in the week commencing the 5th of August.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, it's harder than ever to see your GP. People are phoning hundreds of times when the lines open, only to be given an appointment weeks later. Local surgeries are on their knees, and a lot of the demand that they face is linked to the crisis in mental health. They need dedicated mental health workers alongside them. And in 2021, Nicola Sturgeon agreed with that. She announced that the SNP government would hire 1,000 new staff to lessen the load. Every surgery would benefit by 2026. Well, there's not long to go now. There's just one catch. We've uncovered that 3 years later, not a single one of these workers has been recruited. Not one. Liberal Democrats are dedicated to getting you fast access to your GP. We are dedicated to world-class mental health support. But the SNP have cut mental health budgets time and again and again and again. So can I ask the First Minister, isn't this yet more evidence that the SNP have been in power too long and are letting people down?
First Minister.
No, Presiding Officer, because we've exceeded our commitment to recruit 800 additional mental health workers to A&E's, GP practices, police station custody suites and prisons. We also have invested in mental health support in our schools, with mental health counsellors that are in our schools, to try to provide that early intervention to reduce the crystallisation of demand for CAM services so that young people are supported at an earlier stage. So the government has increased expenditure on the mental health by a 2% cash increase, representing 8.5% of total NHS expenditure. Expenditure on CAMHS has also increased, and the government will continue to take an approach to supporting essential mental health services to assist in meeting the demands and the needs of individuals in our society.
Question number four, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, with regard to the impact on child poverty levels in Scotland, what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the recent research from the Institute for Fiscal Studies on the impact of the two child benefit cap?
First Minister.
So the report shows that the scale of the impact of the two child limit, with an extra 250,000 children in the UK to be affected next year and an extra 670,000 by the end of the next UK Parliament. On average, those households will be £4,300 worse off, representing 10% of their income. The evidence is overwhelmingly clear. Scrapping the Westminster policy will immediately lift children out of poverty. So it's frankly breathtaking that the Labour Party is committed to keeping the two-child cap in place, offering no change to the Tories' austerity agenda.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the First Minister for that response. As he's outlined, the IFS research indicates that when fully rolled out, the two-child benefit cap, which is supported by both Labour and Tories, will affect one in five children, costing families an average of £4,300 a year. So can I ask the First Minister if he can advise what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the impact on child poverty levels if an incoming UK government reversed this cruel policy?
First Minister.
So the recent analysis by the government has estimated that reversing the two-child limit and reintroducing the family element of universal credit would lift 10,000 children out of poverty in Scotland. That, of course, would be welcome in addition to the effectiveness of the child poverty measures the government is already taking, where on the Scottish child payment and on other measures, we are keeping 100,000 children out of poverty as a consequence, and it would be of assistance to us in achieving the fundamental aspiration of this government, which is to eradicate child poverty, if we were to have the assistance and the support of measures from the United Kingdom government by the lifting of the two-child limit, rather than the prolonging of child poverty as a consequence of the maintenance of what is an immoral policy.
Question number 5, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in light of the reported number of serious and fatal accidents on the A9 trunk road in recent weeks, what progress is being made on the dual-link project?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, we are all aware of the harm, disruption and inconvenience caused by road traffic accidents, including the most recent incidents on the A9. I want to express my sympathies to everyone affected by the loss of a loved one, including the family and friends of the individual who was killed in an accident on the A9 last Sunday, and to anyone who has been injured on our roads. As I confirmed at the cross-party meeting I chaired on Tuesday, this government's commitment to dualling the A9 is steadfast, and progress has been made on the timetable that was published in December. Since then, we have progressed the purchase of land for 4 sections in the programme, the procurement of the Tay Crossing to Ballinlough project began in May, and I can advise Parliament today that we are nearing completion of the procurement process and will shortly award the contract for the dualling of the Tamatin-Tamoy section.
Murdo Fraser.
I want to thank the First Minister for that response. He is aware that the busy summer tourist season always brings a spate of serious and fatal accidents on the A9. The latest of these, as he's alluded to, was on Sunday at Calveen with the death of a motorcyclist. This is a terrible tragedy for the family of the man killed, but there was also massive disruption on this major busy arterial route, with the road closed for 7.5 hours, leaving motorists and bus passengers stranded. I'm sure the First Minister would want to join with me in thanking local residents and businesses in Blair Athol, who stepped in with food, drink and accommodation to help those who were affected. But these tragedies will continue until we see the A9 dualled in full, which the SNP government promised would happen by 2025. That promise was broken. The First Minister now says the dualling programme will proceed. Why will it be different this time?
First Minister.
First of all, let me associate myself with the remarks made by Murdo Fraser in relation to the assistance provided by my constituents in the Blair Athol area. The community around Blair Athol and Pitlochry and Dunkeld has had a lot of experience in previous incidents of providing support, and I express my warm thanks to individuals who helped. I should also, for completeness, say that settlements north of the accident at Calveen in Dalwhinnie, Canusia and Newton Moor were also providing assistance to motorists who were inconvenienced. The accident that took place at Calveen was in a particularly difficult place on the road to enable alternative diversion routes to be put in place, and that therefore involved long diversion routes and significant amounts of disruption. And I've asked Transport Scotland, with the Transport Secretary, to look again at the handling of that incident to be certain that all assistance that can be provided will be provided. In relation to the latter part of Mr Fraser's question, the Government, of course, has had to address a number of major infrastructure projects that were part of the ongoing programme that we inherited when we came to office, and some other projects that emerged that had to be addressed. So the Government has completed satisfactorily the Borders Railway, the Leavenmouth Railway, the Airdrie-Bathgate Railway, expansion of a number of stations, the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, which was promised for 40 years and never delivered, the Queensferry Crossing, the M80 completion, the M8 completion and the M74 completion. We've brought forward...
Briefly, First Minister.
I will do, First Minister. We've brought forward the improvements at Lunkerty to Passaburnham on the A9, Kincaig-Dalrady, Cruden Moor and the Ballinlough Junction. So I hope that gives Mr Fraser confidence that the Government delivers.
Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, on Tuesday this week, a cross-party group of MSPs representing all but one parties in the Holyrood Chamber met with the First Minister to discuss the acceleration, the speeding up of the timetable of programming for dualling the A9. Can he now confirm to us all and to Scotland that he will give the most serious consideration to this plea with officials and industry, and also in any financial instrument deployed, will he seek to include provision to deliver our promise on the Nairn bypass as well?
Minister.
Well, the government is committed to delivering the A9 the Nairn bypass and also the dualling of the A9 from Inverness to Nairn. As I indicated to the meeting on Tuesday, the government will, of course, keep the programme under review to identify if there is any way we can move faster. But we've established a strong programme which enables us to deliver on the commitment that we have made. The government's commitment is absolute. But as Mr Ewing will well know from his long experience in government, we have to live within the financial resources that are available to us. We will deploy creativity in trying to expand those resources available to us. But if our capital budget is being cut by 10%, that is a significant challenge to any government of any political colour.
Rhoda Grant.
Listing the projects that have been completed instead of the A9 simply adds insult to injury to the people of the North who have waited too long. Can I therefore ask how much land has been purchased for the A9 and how much remains to be purchased?
First Minister.
I simply set out the projects that the government has delivered, which we put in place to build, to establish the confidence that the government is, you know, is able to deliver capital projects. I've not heard from Rhoda Grant an argument why we shouldn't have done any of the projects that we did. Yeah. And we were actually encouraged by the Labour Party to do other projects that we didn't want to do, yeah, and we had to find the funding for all of that. So I simply put those on the record. In relation to the volume of land that's been acquired, I can't give Rhoda Grant a definitive figure, but I'll write to her in the aftermath of First Minister's questions with the details.
Question number 6, Emma Harper.
To ask the First Minister whether he will provide an update on the Scottish Government's work to roll out the carer support payment.
First Minister.
President Officer, our carer support payment is the 14th benefit delivered by Social Security Scotland and has been available for new applicants in Dundee City, Perth and Kinross and the Western Isles since November 2023. It will operate nationally from November, and on Monday we completed the latest phase of the rollout, opening to new applications in Angus, North and South Lanarkshire. Carer support payment, co-designed with carers and support organisations, extends entitlement to many carers in full-time education, removing barriers to education for around 1,500 carers a year.
Emma Harper.
I thank the First Minister for that response. Carer support payment is Scotland's 14th transformative devolved payment and is benefiting many young carers who would simply not be receiving the financial support they deserve elsewhere in the UK. Will the First Minister urge the next UK government to face up to the devastating effects that a decade of austerity has had on our communities, including unpaid carers, and match the progressive social security ambitions of the SNP Scottish Government?
First Minister.
In relation to the point that Emma Harper makes about the impact of the carer support payment on young people, I might add that from Monday we've extended eligibility for 16 to 19-year-olds in full-time secondary education with exceptional circumstances to have access to that payment, and I do hope that helps to address some of the issues that she raises. The Government is committing a record £6.3 billion for benefits expenditure, which is £1.1 billion more than we received from the United Kingdom Government for Social Security through the Block grant, demonstrating our commitment to tackling poverty. And the investment will support more than 1 in 5 people in Scotland, particularly disabled people, and to assist them in living full and independent lives, enabling older people to heat their homes in winter, and recognising the valuable contribution of unpaid carers to our communities around the country.
Thank you. We move to general and constituency supplementaries. If we keep questions and responses concise, we will be able to involve more members. And I call John Mason.
Thank you. Does the First Minister share my concern at the rate at which Scottish headquarters companies are being taken over by businesses elsewhere, and specifically, most recently, in my own constituency, civil engineers RJ McLeod?
First Minister.
I do understand the concern. I understand the anxiety, particularly for employees of these organisations. There are, of course, examples of Scottish companies acquiring businesses in other parts of the United Kingdom and around the world. So the process of acquisition is and can be a two-way process. But I think part of what the government wants to do is to strengthen the roots of companies within Scotland, strengthening their commitment to the Scottish economy. And the recent data from the Royal Bank of Scotland Purchasing Managers Index demonstrates that Scotland is an attractive place to do business that is attracting a great deal of interest both domestically and internationally.
Ros McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If you are not satisfied with the service you receive, you look beyond the practice and instead hold those with the power to improve matters to account. The Scottish Government needs to do more to directly support general practice, the bedrock of the NHS. Please contact your MSP. This is the statement Fife Local Medical Committee, who represents GPs, practices in Fife, have written to their patients. First Minister, our GPs are the front line of our health service. So what message do you have for the patients in Fife who have been so completely let down by this government in light of this statement?
If I could just remind members to always address the remarks through the chair. First Minister.
President Officer, I greatly value the contribution that general practices make to the nation's health. I want to make sure that GP practices have the support that they need to deliver on their commitments. The government has committed and invested over £1.2 billion in general medical services in the last financial year, and we work in close concert with general practices to make sure they meet the needs of their patients. And the Health Secretary is in regular dialogue with the representatives of the GP practices through the BMA and other organisations, and that will certainly be encouraged by me.
You, Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In recent years, there has been a significant growth in participation in tennis in Scotland, with over 270,000 children playing at least once a year, a 29% increase in children playing weekly, and record levels of club membership. It is welcome also that half of all schools in Scotland are registered to deliver the LTA Youth Schools Programme, a free offer with resources to deliver tennis in a school setting. As Sir Andy Murray, one of Scotland's greatest ever athletes, comes towards the end of his career, how will the Scottish Government work with both Tennis Scotland and the Lawn Tennis Association to capitalise on his success and ensure that every primary age child in Scotland has the opportunity to pick up a racket and try tennis?
Minister.
I think, well, first of all, let me associate myself very much with the sentiments behind Mr Bibby's question. Sir Andy Murray has given exceptional, demonstrable leadership to the encouragement of participation in sport as a consequence of his incredibly successful career. And he has been a great ambassador for Scotland and an ambassador for tennis and for sport. I think the answer to the question lies in some of the points that Mr Bibby has put to me, that it will be through partnership that we make the greatest success. So we're working already with Tennis Scotland, the Lawn Tennis Association and Sports Scotland to support the delivery of tennis activity around the country. There's a £50 million Transforming Scotland's Indoor Tennis Fund, which is a capital investment programme which has been brought together by that partnership, to enable greater use of tennis facilities and to encourage greater participation in tennis. And I assure Mr Bibby of the Government's willing engagement to work with partners to deliver that increased participation.
Anna Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A recent study from researchers at the London School of Economics has indicated that UK Government austerity spending cuts cost the average person in the UK nearly half a year in life expectancy between 2010 and 2019. Given the further substantial austerity cuts that the IFS has warned that both Labour and the Tories are planning, can the First Minister advise what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the impact these Westminster cuts on public health in Scotland?
First Minister.
President Officer, I think it's very clear that the evidence points to the really acute difficulties that Elena Whittam puts on the record today, that if there is a prolonged reduction in public expenditure, it will cause harms to the population. Yep. That is what we are wrestling with today. And that is why I say there has to be a change of direction in the public finances. We have taken decisions here to expand public expenditure to enable investment in our public services. We need to see the fiscal climate of the United Kingdom catching up with us to enable there to be greater investment in the public services of our country.
Graham Simpson.
Thank you. I've been contacted by a constituent with a 38-year-old niece in Lanarkshire who has breast cancer. Treating that will ultimately affect her fertility, but because she's past her 38th birthday, NHS rules say she must pay £5,000 for fertility preservation treatment. If she was an otherwise healthy woman, she could get IVF on the NHS into her 40s, rightly so. But I don't think that's a very fair situation for anyone with breast cancer. So will the First Minister agree to look into this situation as a matter of urgency?
First Minister.
I recognise the sensitivity of the point that Mr Simpson puts to me, and I understand the concern about the difference in approach that is taken in different scenarios. So I am very happy for the relevant ministers, the Health Secretary, the Public Health Minister, to engage directly with Mr Simpson on this question. We'll explore what is possible. There may be clinical issues with which I'm not familiar, but you know, we'll explore that to see if there is a way that can address the points that Mr Simpson puts to me.
Michael Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's plan to downgrade the neonatal intensive care unit at University Hospital Wishaw is dangerous, flawed, and will fail vulnerable babies and families in Lanarkshire. My constituents deserve better, and that's why they have the full support of Scottish Labour. But what about the First Minister? Will he listen to parents, families and healthcare experts and save the unit, the UK award-winning unit, or will this SNP government continue to defend the indefensible?
First Minister.
I understand this is a very significant and sensitive issue in the Lanarkshire area, but the conclusions that have been arrived at by a very detailed and comprehensive process of evidence gathering, and they are based on clinical advice that I think it would be impossible for the government to ignore. So the information that has been gathered together points to the changes that are being proposed, and that approach is based on evidence. Now, this is, of course, an issue looking at babies that are at an extreme level of vulnerability. And as a consequence, I think the logic follows, and the evidence points to this, there is a need for very sophisticated intervention to maximise the possibility of sustaining life. So on that evidence, I think it would be difficult for ministers to ignore that compelling evidence that has been put in front of us. I understand the strength of feeling on this question, but there is a need for ministers to act with responsibility in relation to the evidence that's put in front of us.
Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by declaring an interest as convener of the cross-party group on Taiwan? On June the 12th, the Cabinet Secretary for External Affairs met with the Chinese Consul General in Edinburgh. The purpose of the meeting is not known. But what we do know is that days later, the City of Edinburgh pulled a friendship agreement with the Taiwanese port city of Kaohsiung. We also know that the Chinese officials made public statements of sanctions against academia, aviation and business in the capital city. What I'd like to know, first of all, is the First Minister comfortable with such threats to our capital city? But also, will he instruct the Cabinet Secretary to publish minutes of his meeting with Chinese officials? And in doing so, please explain why he felt it appropriate to intervene on the matter at all.
First Minister.
First of all, the decisions of the City of Edinburgh Council will be a matter for the City of Edinburgh Council. And ministers do not have any direction-making power to local authorities on a matter like this. There will be some issues in which we have... I'm actually not sure if we do have direction-making powers to local authorities because they are independent corporate bodies. So that question I just don't think arises. I certainly don't think it's appropriate for any threats to be issued to public bodies. Public bodies should be free to make their own judgments and come to their conclusions. So I don't agree with that in any shape or form. And I think it's not surprising that the Cabinet Secretary for External Affairs meets the Chinese Consul General. Mr Robertson has an obligation to meet with the consular community on a regular basis. Indeed, I will meet him with the American Consul General this evening to mark his moving on from his posting in Edinburgh. So these are routine discussions, and any decisions for the City of Edinburgh Council are a matter for the City Council.
And Ross Greer.
Th- Thank you. My colleague Patrick Harvey has written to the First Minister and the Lord Advocate to request confirmation of what action Scottish ministers are taking in light of the serious concerns which have come to light about Donald Trump's acquisition of property in Scotland. Mr Trump was recently found guilty on 34 counts in the New York State Supreme Court, including falsifying business records in relation to his Scottish properties. Since 2017, the Scottish Greens have called on ministers to apply for an unexplained wealth order under the Proceeds of Crime Act to investigate Trump's activities in Scotland. For years, ministers have said they cannot confirm or deny whether Trump is under investigation. In that same length of time, an investigation and a court case have now taken place in New York. Faith in Scotland's justice system is being put at risk by the appearance of inaction in the face of potentially serious criminal activity by a rich and powerful individual. So can the First Minister provide an update on whether an unexplained wealth order will be sought against Donald Trump's Scottish business activities?
First Minister.
Sir, I understand the points that Mr Greer makes to me. Obviously, the decisions that arrived at by the Supreme Court in New York are a matter for that court. There is a process that has to be undertaken in Scotland on the whole question of an unexplained wealth order that is taken forward by the Civil Recovery Unit, which is responsible to Scottish ministers under the Proceeds of Crime Act 2002. And it would be a matter for the Civil Recovery Unit to consider. In the light of Mr Greer putting this to me, I will explore if there is anything more that can be said about this, and I will write to him accordingly if there is anything more that can be added to what I have placed on the record today.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions.